The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hola, everyone. Welcome to Open Hybrid. We are back this week at Cherriffe Executive Suite, sign of the times. I'm Rhina Valentin, your host, Café con Leche, every Friday. Here's what's coming up in today's show. Leading things off, we'll speak to the Paige Fraser Foundation's Chief Artistic Officer, Paige Fraser-Hoffman, to discuss their third annual Spine Series workshop. Then we'll be joined by SAGE's Program Coordinator, Cherise Sherriffe, to discuss SAGE's dedication to improving the lives of LGBTQ plus elders. After that, we'll take a look at the highlights of this year's Bronx Pride Festival. Later on in the show, Bobby C brings us an up-to-date latest headlines in the world of sports. And lastly, this week's Open Artist Spotlight shines on pop singer and musician Kyla St. Phard with a performance at the end of the show. So sit back y prepárate, or ese amor is headed your way, because now we are officially open. Hey everyone, welcome to Open Hybrid. I'm Rhina Valentin, your host, Café con Leche, coming to you back from Charri Executive Suite, inviting you to get social with us online. That is, tweet us and follow us on Instagram at BronxNet TV and like us on Facebook at Open BronxNet Television. Of course, while you're there, follow moi on Twitter, FB, Instagram, Insta Stories, and LinkedIn at Rhina Valentin. So June is Scoliosis Awareness Month, and scoliosis is a sideways curvature of the spine. And most cases of scoliosis are considered mild, but some curves can worsen, becoming debilitating. And so our first guest who has appeared on Open on different occasions is a Bronx native, a proud scoliosis advocate, dance captain and swing for the Lion King on Broadway. Woo! And she's also the chief artistic officer of the Paige Fraser Foundation, which aims to create a safe space for artists with and without disabilities. And they offer free arts programs to community through dance, theater, visual arts, music, and wellness. And here to share more is Lion King on Broadway dance captain and swing, Paige Fraser Foundation's chief artistic officer, Paige Fraser Hoffman.
Hi, so good to be here. Hi, Rhina.
Hi. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. I was so excited to know that we were going to have you on. And of course, in honor of Scoliosis Month, because Scoliosis Awareness Month, excuse me, because I think you are the epitome of what it means to live in possibility and be unstoppable.
Thank you so much. Yeah, my journey with scoliosis, definitely a journey, being diagnosed at the age of 13 in high school, and you know, you're growing into your body. And I was at the time beginning at a professional performing arts high school, dancing at Alvin Ailey. So there were a lot of great things happening. And then I'm told by the doctor that I have this condition and that over time it can get worse, and that he recommended surgery. So there was a lot to process and definitely unpack. But my dream and desire to be a professional dancer and to one day be on Broadway definitely burned deeper and is what kept me passionate and focused and just determined to make that dream come true. And, you know, there definitely have been some challenges along the way and aches and pains that come along with having scoliosis, and just the amount of time and energy and focus that goes into maintaining a healthy spine. You know, it's not like I can just wake up out of bed and go hit the show. You know, there's things that I have to do daily within my warm-up, within my routine, to make sure that I have a healthy and aligned spine.
So, and thank you for opening up with that, because we are going to discuss the spine series that you're going to be offering June 25th, which is the other part of just sharing your story and coming from this place of experience, not just, you know, implementing, right? And so with regards to having to operate with this sense of mindfulness, right? And designing the I guess your remedy to be able to forge forward and continue dancing, and dancing on Broadway, no less, people. I can't stop saying that because I'm so proud of you. I mean, we had Paige Fraser on numerous occasions, and so it's been our absolute honor and privilege to share her journey with you all. And so to have her come back on and now be the dance captain and swing on Lion King on Broadway, I'm just beside myself about it. But with that said, the fact that you are committed to passing it forward within the community through your foundation, offering these services, let's talk about first what you do and then how the Spine Series is going to introduce it to anyone who has been diagnosed with scoliosis.
Yeah, so...
and or not, right? I'm sorry, and or not, because it's not solely for people diagnosed with it.
Exactly. Thank you for plugging that, because so the Spine Series, it came to me during the pandemic. I had been so used to going to gyrotonics, which is, I would say, similar to Pilates. You know, you use a machine that helps you through certain exercises. And I was so used to taking dance class, and I was so used to going to yoga, right? And then the pandemic kind of stopped all of that. People weren't leaving their homes. And I found myself in my apartment just itchy, like ready to move, ready to work on my back. And the one thing that having scoliosis, it's really important to continue to move. Oftentimes we hear that, oh, movement can make it worse, or this can make it worse. But for me, I have found that without movement, without breath, without expansion, without lengthening, I start to give into my curvature, right? I start to feel like a couch potato, you know, and things actually hurt more. So Spine Series was born during the pandemic, and I just started reaching out to some of my colleagues and friends that were certified in Pilates, yoga, gyrotonics, a method called Shroth, all these things that are focused on spinal conditions. And what started out as like an Instagram live takeover thing then became a thing through the Paige Fraser Foundation, where we now offer this program once a year. And this year will be our third offering of the Spine Series. And I'm really excited. We have Beth Terranova and Christine Yagaberry. Christine is from the UK. So it's really great, again, to have these resources and share it with the world so people know that they're not alone, and that they can learn new things that they can add to their at-home routine. You know, we'd never want anyone to live in pain. And I think the more that we share this information, it's really great. And that's why I love that this program is on Zoom, because we've been able to reach so many people.
Right. Well, now it's a global affair. And I always bring that up with regards to what we've all endured, right? The silver lining behind this is that I think we've been able to connect on a more expansive level. And the fact that you have somebody who's actually facilitating from the UK, you know, how awesome is that? And I do still want to learn more about what you do on a daily basis. However, since we're talking about the Spine Series, I just want people to know that it is happening on Saturday, June 25th, between 12 and 1:45 Eastern time. And it's important to say that, because obviously it's a global event. And the cost is free. That is like amazing.
Yeah. That is definitely the mission of the Paige Fraser Foundation. All our programming is free, and it's offered to various age groups in the community. Spine Series is one of those special programs because all are welcome. You know, we've had older people and teenagers, and it's beautiful to see on Zoom all these people come together with the similar issue. So that really warms my heart.
Especially during this time. I mean, you said it correctly when you said, you know, we were all, you know, for lack of a better word, locked up for almost 3 years, and we only had a limited movement. If you're a New Yorker like we are, you know, we live in apartments and it's confined spaces, right? I mean, our apartments are not huge, and so even if you have a two bedroom like I do, it's still not the same as walking on a regular basis, which is what we're used to as New Yorkers, which of course impacts us all with regards to our back. Our lower back specifically. So, and I'm sharing that just to say that this is something that I think a lot of people can benefit from, a lot.
Absolutely.
And also it's for ages 12 and up. So you can make it a family affair as well.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's, again, at the age of 13, that's when I was diagnosed. So I think, I do know if people who have been diagnosed younger, and I, you know, if they want to come, feel free. You know, again, this really is just about sharing information and allowing people that may not have the resources to take gyrotonics, to take yoga, you know, that they can have this free opportunity and ask questions and just simply, if they want to just observe. And you don't have to have scoliosis to participate. You can have chronic back pain, you know, that is just caused by an accident in your life. You know, everyone is welcome.
That's wonderful. So we are running short on time, but I do want to make sure that people know what the process is. Is there a registration involved?
Yes. So if everyone can go to the PageFraserFoundation.org, we have an events page, and we also are on Eventbrite. So if you just look us up on Eventbrite, it's very easy to sign up. And I do want to also shout out some of our other programs that are coming up. We have Dance to Bond, which starts in July, and that is for parents and their young kids to share in movement and also just bonding and creating a space for a parent to connect with their child in a different way. And then we also offer meditation series in August and September. We have a lot coming up and a lot for people to look forward to.
That's wonderful. And of course, they can find that all on your website. And I'll be announcing that shortly. But before we go, I want to say I am so excited to make my way to Broadway to see you perform Lion King.
Yes, it is definitely a production. And it's really exciting. I love being a swing. I get to do many different roles. And it keeps it fresh for me. And I'm proud of myself, you know.
This, you're
it is a different way of thinking and operating, and us swings, we're holding it down. So yes, come on into the Lion King.
Woo, congratulations once again on all of your endeavors, Paige Fraser Hoffman, once again, our proud Lion King Broadway shining star and Chief Artistic Officer for the Paige Fraser Foundation. And once again, the Paige Fraser Foundation's third annual Spine Series Workshop is taking place on Saturday, June 25th at 12 noon on Zoom. And for information and registration, visit the PageFraserFoundation.org. We do have to take a quick break, but when we return, we'll hear about the world's largest and oldest organization dedicated to the lives of LGBTQ elders. Don't go anywhere. Thank you. welcome back. So as Pride Month continues, we honor the trailblazers within the LGBTQ plus community. And, you know, it is important for us to remember the pioneer elders and their efforts, as well as the sacrifices for equality and inclusion. Some of these issues addressing aging within the community are sometimes overlooked. So our next guest is the program coordinator at SAGE, the world's largest and oldest organization dedicated to improving the lives of LGBTQ plus elders. And they offer services from arts and culture to health and wellness, as well as innovative services throughout New York City and nationwide. So here to share more is SAGE's program coordinator, Cherise. Cherise.
Hello. How are you? How's everyone? Good. Good to see you. Good. Happy Pride Month.
Happy Pride. Happy
yes, Pride. We're ready.
I know. Everybody's all excited.
Yes.
In-person occasion.
Yes.
Woo. And so thank you for being here with us representing SAGE and with your background really being geared more towards the elders, the seniors. If you wouldn't mind just sharing a little bit more about the services that SAGE offers as a community, for the community as a whole.
Hi, well, my name is Sherriffe. I'm the program coordinator with SAGE. So SAGE is the largest program for older adults, LGBT. And we focus on caregiving, we focus on care management, we focus on congregate meals, we focus on art, culture, and a very host of activities that will help them also age in place, but also have activities that's geared for LGBT and older adults. So it's a combination.
I see. And so is this a on-location premise that people come and visit and leave?
Yes, so our doors open from usually 9 to 5 or 10 to 4, and people come in for activities such as the art from the heart. They come in for creative wellness. They come in for health and nutrition. And the main thing is our congregate meals, which is for people who are socially isolated and just to be with their cohorts and share a meal. And that is funded through the Department for the Aging.
So because it is geared towards the LGBTQ plus community, and I just noticed you mentioned it's actually inclusive, is there anything in particular that's offered within the programming that is geared towards that community that becomes relatable being in the space and in conversations with each other?
So one thing we do all of our creative things together. We do art together. We make jewelry together. There's really nothing besides like supportive groups for LGBT. We have a social group from LGBT. We have a once a month, what we call it, the Rainbow Social that we just started up, where there's a little bit of everyone in there. But this premise started from the LGBT community. It started that as we age, sometimes we're not going to clubs. So we create that environment of food, love, music together right here at the center.
Oh no, you didn't just say you have dance parties. Did I just hear you have dance parties?
Oh yes, we have dance parties. We had a dance party last week and I'm still recovering.
And so I'm gonna assume those dance parties are matinees.
So no, we do soul train lines. We dance together, all ages. We also have an intergenerational program for LGBTQ younger adults.
All right, so it sounds like you have all kinds of different activities that are all inclusive, but are geared more towards the elders within the LGBTQ plus community. So do people have to become members? And so how do they
the basic concept is you're 60 years and over. You come, you register for free. We get the basic demographics. You know, we don't pry. Whatever you put on that application is confidential, but that also entitle you to come to all the free programs that we have. If you can't afford lunch, we only ask for a suggested donation. All the materials we supply is free. Everything that we do in the senior center, we give to the older adults that are 60 years and over. If you don't have the $2 or $3 to eat. You can put in a penny. It's fine with us. We won't turn anyone away.
So, all right, that's wonderful. Food is one of the services that obviously is very important within the community in offering that I guess that sense of safety, that safe sense it's, of safe.
And right? That's the yes, and let me go back again. The big issue is the safety issue. Where you come in here, you're not judged. You're not mistreated. You're not excluded. This is, the Bronx is a very warm, all the centers are very warm, loving environment that you could come and be yourself in our environment with no judgment at all.
So let me ask you this, right? So, and that's wonderful. And it's so important because I think we're all looking for that.
Yes.
All right.
And of so course.
This community, and you chose to use the word isolation, right? And so there's these layers of whatever trauma one may be dealing with. And then there's this COVID layer that's added an additional trauma. Are there like mental health services that are offered there?
So or, you know, also we have
needed. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Got it. Yeah. So not interrupting. Also, we have a care management team and we are in collaboration with Service for Older People. So we also have a therapist that come. We have a care manager. We have a housing coordinator. We have a lot of hosts. I have a master's in gerontology, which focus on programs for older adults. We are a team of collective disciplines that come together because there are a host of different variables that come in, like mental health, you know, sometimes of substance abuse, sometimes caregiving issues. We try to tackle everything and we don't leave you hanging. And if we can't, Sage can't do it, we will refer you out to another agency. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's wonderful. And thank you for breaking it down like that, because I think it's important that people, especially our audience that's watching right now, to understand that these places are accessible to you.
And yes.
The best word that you chose to use is like, this is a judgment-free zone. Like
very much.
We're here to welcome you with open arms.
Yes, we're here to open our arms. And let me add also to the community. The people need this in the community. There's no senior center in a close, I'm gonna say 20 block radius of this area. We're located at 1784 Prospect Avenue in the South Bronx. We are new development, which also we have housing connected to it for older adults. So we have a little gamut of everything. We have housing coordinators that help with the paperwork. We have a care manager that helps for LGBT concerns and issues. There's nothing that we are not touching on, to be honest. We have exercise, yoga, chair exercise, nutrition classes, art classes, creative wellness, any kind of therapeutic environment, but this is a center that you come and go as you please.
Right. And I understand you actually, just because you're mentioning all of these resources that you created, like a resource book in 2000, yes. Updated. So is that accessible right now online or?
Oh, yes. You can go to www.sageusa.com and look at every center, Midtown, the Bronx, Brooklyn, and Staten Island. And not only that, Sage website is just powerful. We are an agency that gives information, shares it all for the public to see. So you just go to that website, you can see events, the Pride Parade, different venues that the Sage workers and the Sage staff, Sage volunteers are all over. We have a pantry that was MetLife, that this was their first time yesterday coming to bring food to the seniors, to the older adults and community. So we have a few pantries. We have Common Pantry, we have the Love Wind Pantry. No one can come in this door hungry and we will feed everyone.
What a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful way to live and service. Oh my God.
Yes, yes. Service driven. We're very service driven here, very.
You can tell. And so that being said, right, in closing, because you said, oh, we got our dance on, I'm still recovering from it.
Yes.
You know, I'm still sore from it. So
yes.
You guys are getting warmed up to march in the parade.
Hey, love. Yes, we all, one thing about SAGE is we do a little bit of, it's a website, and we have a team site where we can pick what event that each of us want to do. Some of us do parades, some of us do barbecue, some of us host dances, some of us do brunch. We all share the events with each other, and we all come out as much as we can to support each other.
So y'all are marching or you're floating down?
we're doing both.
All right.
We're floating. We're having a ball. And so many people are looking forward since they've been isolated. So there's so many people that are ready. They have their t-shirts. They have their tambourines. They are ready to go and ready. They're ready.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, we thank you for sharing all of this knowledge with our viewers.
Thank you.
And we are excited for you because you seem excited about
I'm very excited.
I know.
Yes. Yes, thank you. Thank you. And thank you for the invite, Sage. Thank you. And thanks for the continuous support.
Absolutely. And you guys, once again, that's Cherise Program Coordinator at Sage. And if you're interested in more information and resources, please visit sagenyc.org. We are continuing with a Celebrating Pride Month. We're going to take a look at the highlights of this year's Bronx Pride Festival. Don't go anywhere.
Bronx Borough President Vanessa Gibson hosted the Bronx Pride and Allies Celebration. The office of Vanessa Gibson provided free food, drinks, performances, and of course, the best thing of all, love and laughter for the Pride community.
This is our celebration of Pride. 2 years of a pandemic has reminded us that it's important for us to get together as best we can, love on each other, support the LGBTQIA+ community, the transgender non-conforming, to make sure that everyone knows you can love who you want. It doesn't matter. And I want to make sure that the LGBT community knows they have an ally in their borough president, because we not only have a task force on LGBT issues, where we're working with many community organizations, many of our sponsors tonight, but we're also focusing on policy, budgetary, supporting the LGBT youth that are runaway and homeless and in foster care. We have to amplify their voices. So we've honored so many in the LGBT community. During this month of Pride, we raised the Pride flag at Bronx Borough Hall because we want the entire borough to know how happy we are to celebrate the LGBT community.
We are here today because we're celebrating Pride Month, thanks to the Bronx Borough President, Vanessa Gibson, and we are at my restaurant, Roses at Park. I love any Bronx event to be happening at my space. I just love supporting, bringing people together. But most importantly, I think it's the month of love, and I just want everybody to come together and just feel special.
So happy to be the host tonight, as well as the performer. This event is so important to the Bronx, especially because we have to speak up against the inequalities that still exist in the LGBTQ+ community. So this events like this bring about visibility, and I'm so proud of the borough president, Vanessa Gibson, and her team for bringing events like this to the masses.
What this month means to me is I get to have a designated time to do what I have now set forth to do every day, is to celebrate myself. Now we have a set month, and everyone is starting to join in with us and support. And I see as time goes on, more people are joining in, and it's becoming a bigger thing. And that's just so wonderful. It wasn't always like that. We didn't always have that. So for me, it means it's our time. It's my time. It's your time. It's the world's time, because we are a part of the world. We are here. It's not anything new. It's been here since the dawn of time, and now it's time that we acknowledge that.
As you can see behind me, the party is just getting started here at the Bronx President Pride Celebration. For BronxNet, this is Kyrie Moody.
We begin with a major return here in the Bronx. Summer doesn't really get rolling until the Cruise Brothers say that it does. Hoops in the Sun is back at Orchard Beach, And Father's Day weekend was a glorious opportunity to usher in year number 22 in the BX. We highlighted the Cruise Brothers right here on BronxNet the last 2 weeks. Opening weekend included the unveiling of their new mural project on the Joe Pops Cruz Senior Memorial Courts. Father's Day, always a tribute to the brothers' dad, the late founder of the community basketball tournament. Local dignitaries and other luminaries, including BronxNet Executive Director Michael Max Nobby, presided over the grand opening of the Mount Everest of streetball in the Bronx. With that said, our BronxNet Player of the Week goes to the Cruise Brothers, or should I say, Co-Players of the Week, for providing youth here in the Bronx with the pilgrimage that is hits. The league has given youngsters an alternative to the streets for over two decades, and at the same time has become a factory for both college and pro talent from overseas to the NBA. New York City stars like Kenny Satterfield, Kimball Walker, and the Knicks' Obi Toppin. The list just keeps growing summer after summer. Hits headlines here on 5 on 5 at number 5. In at 4, a New York basketball legend is calling it a career. WNBA megastar Sue Bird, the league's all-time assist leader, will retire at the end of the 2022 season. The 41-year-old posted the announcement on her social media. The 12-time All-Star and 8-time All-WNBA selection had previously considered retiring at the end of the 2021 campaign. But this past offseason, she signed a 1-year deal with the Seattle Storm, where she has spent her entire 21-year WNBA career. Here's more with the former UConn star out of Syosset, New York.
It wasn't about the game. It wasn't about how I played. It was just really about soaking it all in, enjoying the moment, knowing there are people here that, you know, like I've said to everybody already, but knowing that there are people here that have been so instrumental in my journey to get to where I'm sitting right now. It was really about that. You know, and then of course, once the ball gets tipped, you play to win. I would have taken the win, even if I had 0.0 assists, you know, 10 turnovers, I would have been thrilled. It wouldn't have mattered. The fact that, you know, I hit that last shot is almost, it just can put a smile on I know on my face, and I think it could put a smile on everybody's face.
Bird's final professional basket in her childhood home of New York rimmed around, bounced up, and fell through to put a definitive end to the Seattle Storm's 81-72 win over the New York Liberty last Sunday. Afterward, in her post-game interview with ESPN, the legend trolled Brooklyn fans at the Barclays Center, saying, "Bing bong," in reference to the New York Knicks' rallying cry. A real legend. And how about a hand for a friend of our show, moving up in the broadcasting ranks, another voice out of the Bronx, courtesy of Fordham University and WFUV, and that's Justin Shackle. With John Sterling skipping some Yankee games in the second half of the season to keep himself fresh, WFAN will use fill-in broadcasters at least for 25 games. That has opened up an opportunity for Justin to step in. Shackle got the call for games in Toronto this past week, broadcasting the 17th, 18th, and the 19th for the Yankees. He regularly serves as a digital reporter for the team and also contributes to John Boy Media. Talk about living a dream. Congrats to Justin Shackle. And I love his tweet, too, an ode to the great voice of the Yankees, Mel Allen. How about that? Speaking of how about that, the Yankees keep rolling with the best record in Major League Baseball after taking 2 of 3 last weekend in Canada. The Bombers and the Mets share the 2 spot here on the front end of 5-on-5, especially with both managing the best marks in their respective leagues. Yanks sport the best record in the American League, not just baseball. The Mets won 2 out of 3 last weekend and have the best record in the National League. That story, that narrative just keeps rolling here as hopefully, you know, we could see a Subway Series this October. With the Pinstripers touring Toronto, this Bronx boy was making Montreal and Quebec, Canada his playground last weekend as Formula One took center stage there for the first time since the pandemic. What a magnificent circuit that is. We got a tour of the track and an insider look at the new 2022 Formula One cars. A thing of beauty right there. Check this out. As for the action on the track, reigning champion Max Verstappen kept his cool and completed a nice Sunday drive as Red Bull was just a bit stronger than the Ferrari of Carlos Sainz Jr. Carlos pushed, but Super Max held him off. Lewis Hamilton had the best finish of his season, capturing 3rd place to join Max and Carlos on the podium. He was followed by his teammate at Mercedes, George Russell, who finished 4th. The sights, sounds, and thrills of Formula One appropriately take the one spot here on 5-on-5. We shift gears and look ahead here on the back end of 5-on-5. At number one, NFL camps are in swing with the season just a couple of months away. These mini camps give teams like the New York Giants and the Jets a chance to regroup and prepare for the upcoming season. Out at Jets camp, up-and-coming signal caller Zach Wilson is pumped.
It hasn't felt much different really from OTAs. I know E was a little banged up last week, but we've had a majority of the time. So, you know, those guys have done a really good job. You can see the improvement that they've made overall. And then Garrett coming in and, you know, he's getting better every single day as we're going. So I'm excited about the group that we have.
And so are we for the return of football. In the two spot, our weekly Judge Report. Although Yankee star Aaron Judge has opted to pass on the Home Run Derby in Los Angeles next month when the All-Star Game arrives at Dodger Stadium, the Judge is living a Home Run Derby weekly here in the Bronx. He now has 25 homers on the season. No one else in the league had more than 18 when he connected on number 25. Coming into the week, he's on pace for 65 dingers in his contract year. That would break the Yankee mark of 61 set by Roger Maris in 1961. It would also put him in the conversation for the single-season MLB record down the stretch of the season. That number remains 73, held by Barry Bonds. In the three and four spots, a double-double on this date in Bronx sports history. On June 24th, 1936, at Comiskey Park, 21-year-old rookie Joe DiMaggio ties three major league records in New York's 10-run fifth inning against the White Sox, hitting two home runs for eight total bases. With two doubles, he equals the modern record of four long hits in a game at the time. Jody becomes the first Yankee and fifth player in Major League history to hit two home runs in one inning, and that's how the legend of the Yankee Clipper would grow. And on this same date, decades later, more memories here in the Bronx. On June 24th, 1962, a marathon between the Tigers and the Yankees concludes in the 22nd inning when Jack Reed's home run, his only one in the big leagues, gives New York and Jim Boughton a 9-7 win. Reed replaced Joe Pepitone in the 13th inning for Detroit. Phil Regan takes the loss, and Rocky Colavito has seven hits for the Tigers. Fun fact here, Rocky is from the Bronx. Bobby Richardson ties a mark by going to the plate 11 times in that game. At an even 7 hours, the game is the slowest extra inning contest in league history, and it is the longest game in Yankees history, all on this date. We wrap with a look ahead for the two baseball clubs this weekend. The Yanks are home to host rival Houston in the Bronx. Meantime, the Mets are in Miami to face the Marlins for a road weekend series in Florida. Those are the headlines to the C-List for a tribute to a Bronx hoops legend. Lenny Rosenbluth might be before your time, but he should be a name that you never forget in the world of basketball. Lenny led North Carolina to its first basketball NCAA title in 1957 with a victory over all-time legend Will Chamberlain at Kansas in that year's championship game. The former Bronx standout sadly passed away last Saturday. He was 89 years old. Born and raised in the Bronx, Rosenbluth joined coach Frank McGuire and the Tar Heels in 1955 and was an All-Atlantic Coast Conference honoree in each of his three seasons. His number 10 is one of only eight jerseys retired by UNC, along with legendary names like Michael Jordan. He averaged 28 points per game in 1957, still the school record, and beat out Chamberlain for the claim to the College Basketball Player of the Year award. That 57 Tar Heels team went a pristine 32-0, capping its run with a triple overtime victory over Chamberlain's Jayhawks. Rosenbluth scored 20 points in that championship game. Rest in peace, Lenny. We do hope that you are hooping in heaven. That's your look at sports. I'm Bobby C. We'll be right back.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Open. Our last guest is a young pop artist on the rise. Her authenticity and raw emotion has the power to connect with people from all different walks of life. Growing up loving music and dreaming of being a pop star, everything was put on pause when she started struggling with depression and the passing of her brother. Since then, Kyler began putting those indescribable feelings into song, and songwriting became her most effective tool in healing and coping as she navigated through treatment for her mental health. She is now an advocate for mental health awareness and encourages people to have open conversations about their emotions. And even more so, she wants to be able to let people know that they're not alone. You guys are not alone. We're not alone. We're all in this together. Here now to share more is singer-songwriter Kyler St. Phard. Hello and welcome.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah, we're excited to share you with our viewers. Aside from you, your magnificent music.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really enjoy your flavor. And then, of course, the prolific language that's inside of it, which is what we're going to discuss, right? So I did mention the passing of your brother, but what I didn't mention is how he passed, because I wanted you to share with everyone when and what occurred and the impact it had on you. And if you wouldn't mind like sharing the age more or less of when everything kind of shifted for you. You know, I just want to let our viewers know that she did audition for American Idol as well, which we have footage of, but it didn't make the airwaves. So I just wonder like what all this roller coaster ride looked like in a timeline.
Yeah, so my freshman year of high school, when I was 15, my older brother, Kobe, he was a senior. And in March 2016, when he was 18, he died by suicide. So that was really just a completely life-altering event. He was a very popular kid and a star athlete, and everybody knew him. He was kind of known for putting a smile on everyone's face. And so it was very much a shock to a lot of people, and it sent shockwaves through our community. At that point in time, I had to stop going to school because it was too difficult. So I ended up going online and just kind of navigating all of that, the grief process, having everybody around and kind of in our business was a lot to deal with at 15. And tried to distract myself as much as I could at first, but the more I leaned into it, the more music really became my best device at carrying on. And that includes both like listening to artists that I love and admire, and also writing my own music. And writing is something that I've always loved, and I've been doing it forever. I think I probably started writing songs when I was like second or third grade, and they weren't much good for a while. But when I personally started struggling with depression, I was about 12 years old when it got bad. And before I really knew what that was, the only way I knew how to talk about it or describe it was to write songs about it. And there's one song in particular that is actually going to be my next single that is really close to my heart, because I wrote it from a very, very vulnerable place where I felt lonely and scared. And I felt like nobody knew what was going on with me, because especially when you're that young, you know, your friends and your teachers and stuff, they don't really know. And when I was in middle school, it was not something that was talked about enough. So writing this song really helped me kind of figure
out. What's the name of it, if you don't mind sharing?
It's called Puzzle Pieces.
Puzzle Pieces. And the reason I ask is because 12 years young is, you know, I'm a mom to a 12 years young. So I understand what you're talking about, like wholeheartedly, in the sense of navigating through your own identity and trying to figure out where you belong or how you belong or if you even matter. Like there's all kinds of stuff going coming up, and that is like if you don't have the outlet to express that, that's a lot to bottle up.
Exactly. And when I was really starting to deal with depression, all of the things that used to make me happy, they didn't anymore, and I kind of lost who I was. And writing this song, Puzzle Pieces, was so helpful and healing to me. And I when I wrote it, I was writing it as a letter to myself to keep going and pushing through. And I really like the metaphor of a puzzle, because I think the puzzle represents, you know, who you are as a person in your whole life. And how I felt when my depression came on was that, you know, some of these pieces that came together to make me were missing. And so I put this song together and I kind of kept it to myself for a few years. But after my brother passed away, I wanted other people to hear it. And it actually is one of maybe two or three songs I've written that my brother did get to hear before he passed away. So that's also really cool to me. But once my brother passed away, people actually started listening to me, which, you know, obviously him passing was a horrible thing, but, you know, there were a few things that came from it that were really important and, you know, have become good things. And I think what makes me most proud, especially about my whole family, is that we've managed to make a lot of good come from this. And we've, you know, leaned into just using the attention that we got to hopefully spread a good message. My family started a charity. It's called the Be the Light Foundation, in honor of my brother. And we really just want to promote, you know, talking about mental health and having conversations. And we've especially been focusing on reaching out to teens, because, you know, that's where I was when I started struggling, and that's where my brother was when he passed away. So I think that music is just this really cool, unique way that I can share what I've been through and reach out to people and, you know, just let them know that what you're dealing with is not, you know, this crazy freak thing, and there are other people struggling, and it's not your fault. You can absolutely get help and get better.
And so what was the name of the organization again?
We created the organization, and it's called the Be the Light Foundation.
Be the Light.
Yes.
Be the Light.
After my brother passed away, all of his classmates wrote on little note cards memories that they had of him. And so many of them described him as being a light and how he would light up a room and make others really happy. And we wanted to really cherish that and hold on to that. And so we named the foundation after that as a way to honor him and continue on his legacy.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. And then of course you do it through songwriting. So how many songs do you have under your belt already? And what is your primary messaging within the storytelling, right? Is it coming from your introspective thoughts, or is it from experiences, or is it both? Like, I just to help us understand, like, how the actual songwriting has become your healing mechanism.
So as I mentioned, I've been writing songs for a while now. At this point in time, I only have one officially released, but I have dozens and dozens of songs that I've written. And what I think is really cool about songwriting is that you don't have to stick to one method of it. So some of my early songs are definitely more of me coming from my perspective. But as I've grown up and met more people and gone through more things, I find myself more frequently writing from somebody else's perspective. And I have a really strong sense of empathy, and that can actually be very overwhelming. So music is another way to like cope with that as well. And I found that like writing songs about other people's experiences really helped me to figure out how I feel about my own. And, you know, I'll start writing a song from somebody else's perspective, and then I'll find myself throwing in lines that, you know, specifically relate to me. And I don't ever want to like box myself in, you know. If I just kind of write songs as they come out and as they're meant to happen, you know, whether one line's from somebody else's perspective and the other one's mine or whatever, but just whatever really just makes the best song and makes the most sense and tells a good story.
So as we wrap up the segment, can you set us up for the single we're about to hear, Here's Two?
Yes. So I decided Here's Two would be my debut single because initially, just a lot of people were enjoying it, and I thought that'd be a good way to open up my official songbook to the world. I wrote it about a boy I was very much in love with, and we had been through something similar, so we really had a connection, but he didn't feel that same way about me, and I really just spent a lot of time feeling sorry for myself and trying to get over him, and writing this song was just really healing for me, as most music is, because, you know, I kind of went through all of the things that I was feeling, and it almost is like an emotional roller coaster, but it kind of has an happy ending where I'm like, I should be focusing myself. I don't need to waste my time anymore on this. And, you know, I mentioned things that really refer to my mental health, which I think is special because it's a good introduction into that. But it's also, you know, a fun, upbeat pop song. I think a lot of teenagers and young people can relate to it because, you know, it's unrequited love. It's heartbreak, but, you know, you grow and you get through it. And I'm really proud that this is my first song out.
Well, we're proud of you and thank you for sharing so much. The song definitely lends itself to sharing the importance of what it means to have a connection to yourself. Yeah, that's right. That's Kyler St. Phard. You guys don't go anywhere because when we return, she is going to perform for us after the break and you don't want to miss. Welcome back to Open. Here now to perform her debut single, Here's Two. Let's give it up for Kyler St. Phard.
Thinking about you, I strum until my fingers bleed.
And that was Here's To by Kyler St. Phard, and we are advocating mental wellness. Mi gente, Here's To is out now on all streaming platforms. And for more information on Kyler, you can check her out on Instagram at Kyler St. Phard. That is our show today, mi gente. Thanks to all our guests for coming through, and to you, our viewers, for tuning in. If you missed any part of the show, you can check out the Recablecast tonight and 24 hours a day at BronxNet.tv. I'm Rhina Valentin, and from all of us here at Open, may the universe provide paz, prosperity, y amor, and happy Pride, mi gente.